So hello everyone, thank you for joining me today. I'm really excited to be sharing with you some information about the 2020 Hour of Code. My name is Sue Carter and I'm the Northern Territory-based Digital Technologies Project Officer for the CSER program. So let's get started. Firstly, I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we all work and live and recognise their continuing connection to land, water and community. Today, I'm coming to you from Darwin and that's the land of the Larrakia people. So I pay my respects to elders past, present and emerging. Now, today we're using Zoom for our webinar series, and I'd just like to remind people if you could please keep your microphone muted during the session. Feel free to ask questions in the chat. This session is being recorded, so you may like to stop your video. And as I said, all questions can go into the chat space. So today's session is all about the Hour of Code, and we're going to go through the following. What is the Hour of Code? Why you should run an Hour of Code activity? How to get involved, the registration process, which is quite simple. And then the actual teaching of the Hour of Code activities and the five steps that you'll need to consider. We'll have a look at some of the Hour of Code activities, and then I'd love people to have a try and see which activity you might be able to use with your students, and then consider what could you do beyond the Hour of Code. Now, as I mentioned before, I work as a project officer for the Computer Science Education and Research team. And we have a range of massive open online courses, and they're all around the digital technologies curriculum, and we've recently released some cyber safety ones as well. We also have a national lending library, and we encourage teachers to register for that, and we can share some fantastic resources with you. And the Hour of Code fits in nicely to this whole picture of computer science. So what is the Hour of Code? Basically, it's a global event. It's held every year during Computer Science Week. And it's for students to learn about how to do coding and what computer science is all about. It first started in 2013, and there have been over 100 million students across the globe who have enjoyed some form of computer science activity, be it plugged, online or unplugged, that's without a computer. And we've had over 70,000 educators, just like yourself, join these programs. They come to you in a range of different languages, across 45 languages across the world, and no experience is needed. There are a number of partners that are associated with running the Hour of Code event. They include Google, the Khan Academy, Microsoft, Facebook, and many others that you'll see as we start to look at the activities. As I mentioned, this is held during Computer Science Education Week. This year, it's between the 7th and 13th of December. And lucky for some of us, it's still during school time. It's held during December because it's in recognition of Grace Hopper's birthday. Her birthday was the 9th of December. You may ask, who is Grace Hopper? She was a computer scientist. She was one of the first women who was part of the Harvard Mark I computer that was used during World War II. In fact, there were some problems with the computer, and although they attribute the term a bug in the system with her, that's not quite true. In fact, she may have had something to do with sharing this information. What happened was there was uh, a, a moth inside a computer and the computer was glitching and they opened it up. And hence we now have this term when there are computer issues, there's a bug in the system. But the goal of Computer Science Education Week is to share out with our students what computer science is about. It's a career pathway. And through Hour of Code, we'd like to increase the access and equity of computer science for our students. So looking across the world, each dot shows you where an Hour of Code event is going to happen across our world in 2020. So far, 50,000 events have been registered with over 180 countries. In Australia alone, we have now 550 registrations as of the 20th of November. Hopefully, over the next 2 weeks, that figure will double as schools start to come on board and different organisations come on board with registering their events. To find out if an event has been registered, if you're unsure about your school or your area, if you go to thehourofcode.com/AU for Australia and look at events, you can look at all the events for Australia or indeed across the world. Now you might be wondering why, what is an Hour of Code got to do with me and my teaching? Well, we do have a digital technologies curriculum and we do encourage design thinking, systems thinking, but also the computational thinking. And it's the computational thinking part that coding fits into beautifully. And what we're doing is nurturing our problem solving skills, the logic and the creativity of our students. And we know that technology is transforming industry on the planet, and we want to give our students the opportunity to learn how to create with technology, not just be users of it. A lot of our things today, particularly with artificial intelligence, with developing films, a lot of things have to do with coding in the background. And so we'd like our students to be able to learn this new language. It's also the foundation for a 21st century career pathway. Most of all, we really want our students to have fun as they embark down the computer science career. Now, studies have shown that there are lots of cognitive benefits for coding, such as I mentioned, logical thinking skills, problem solving skills, and we'd like students to actually be working in collaboration with one another. And more information about this can be found at the data science website link. And maybe Celia, our wonderful host, if you could pop that into the chat, if anybody would like to follow that up later. So let's move on about how to sign up and how to host an event. Let's watch this video to begin with, and then I'll explain what the process is.
Okay, now you're going to press run.
So Celia, I'm not here. Oh, I'm just going to play that again because it looks like I accidentally muted it.
The Hour of Code.
Your teacher says you guys are into it.
We are. It's very awesome.
Students around the world had an Hour of Code today.
It's part of a global movement to show kids what it takes to create the programs and apps they spend so much time using.
The largest education events in history.
Organizers set what they called an ambitious goal of reaching 10 million students this week. Almost 15 million signed up.
This week, I'm proud to join the students, teachers, businesses, and nonprofit organizations taking new steps to support computer science in America's schools.
You guys are already getting a head start on taking over the world.
I got it.
They've been so excited about it.
Oh my gosh, it's working. I did it right.
They don't even have to be a computer science engineer. Maybe they want to do something else. But in our world, this is going to be the basis for everything that we do.
Move. Semicolon.
Look what I did.
It's so beautiful.
When you're building a program, you have to think outside of the box.
If you can change technology, you can change the world.
I challenge girls in every single country to learn 1 hour of code.
Every district should do, every district can do it.
Please help us get the hour of code to every school and every classroom and every child.
And my school's doing it.
So I love seeing those children, just the delight on their faces as they're engaging. It's quite exciting. So let's have a look how quickly we can go through this process. At the hourofcode.com.au website, there's a section there for you to be able to register. And it's as simple as typing in your name, typing in your email, writing which country you're from, choosing Australia, and then the event type you're going to have. And generally that is around whether it's in a school or if it's in a community. Then if you tick the boxes, if your event is going to be a whole district or community or not, and whether or not you need some help with a software engineer. Now, we wouldn't be ticking that one because that one is specific for America, where they have lots of volunteers that go out and work in schools and in community events. So probably don't tick that one. And then when you click sign up, you'll receive an email and links in the email showing you where you can get a whole lot of resources and the sorts of things you need to do.
Okay, now you're going to press run.
Sorry, didn't mean to do that. So let's have a look now at how to plan your hour of code to make it a successful event for your school or your district, your library, your university, your college, whichever area you're in. There's five really simple steps to go through. You want to plan it. You want to promote it, you want to prepare it, get into the coding, and then celebrate at the end of it. So let's have a look at step one. You need to think about where you're going to run your Hour of Code event. So if you're in a school, is it going to be in your classroom as a teacher? Is it going to be in a computer lab? Are there going to be more than one class coming in and engaging in the activities? Is it going to happen in your school library? Is it something that you want to happen across the school at the same time? Is it going to be on one day? Is it going to be staged over a number of days? Are you thinking about a number of different activities? So just have a think about where and how you want it to run in your area. Then have a think about what type of activities you want to do, because the Hour of Code doesn't have to be in front of a device. You can do the plugged activities that have been developed, the tutorials, which are very much self-led, but you can do unplugged activities as well. And there's a number of those on the website, and they show you on the website what they look like. You'll need to consider, if you're going to use devices, which devices do you need? Are you using desktops or laptops? Are they iPads? Are they smartphones? And think about your connectivity as well. Will your students need headphones? If you're going to have one student per device, you might like to think about headphones. If you're going to team your students up, if they're going to collaborate together, share together, then you wouldn't need the headphones. Then there's the how-to video. So it's a good idea to watch the how to run your Hour of Code. And you might like to do that with some of your teachers in the school. you might like to run some mini sessions on coding for teachers and get other people on board with it with you. It's a good idea maybe to have some techsperts where some students go through the tutorials prior to you as a class or as a school engaging in them, just so you've got some helpers alongside if some people get stuck along the way. Then schedule, as I mentioned before, how are you going to schedule across your week or across your day for the activities to happen? And are you going to need to have a virtual event? Considering our COVID situation and whether schools are open or closed, you never know from one week to the next. So maybe have an idea of what a virtual event might look like as well. Then the second part of the process is to promote it, because it's no good just having it if it's just in your classroom and nobody knows about it, or it's happening at your school but it's not shared with your community. So on the Hour of Code website, they have a number of promotional materials that can assist you in getting information out. So you might want to tell parents that you're having an event at your school. You might like to do this through a newsletter or use your Facebook page for your school or some form of social media. You might like to promote it by putting some posters up around your community. You might want to invite the media in to attend your event, or even look at your local MP and maybe they'd like to come and visit on the day. The Hour of Code also have some brochures, and you might like to consider sending those brochures out to families. There are some posters that they have on their website, and you could print those posters out and put those around your school as well and in the classroom. And then they have a number of videos as well. These are inspirational videos from people who talk about their own coding journeys, their own career pathways, and the type of computer science work that they're involved with. Then prepare. It's really important to make sure that you are prepared and any of your teachers are prepared. This might be the hardest part, choosing a tutorial. There's over 100 different one-hour student-guided tutorials to choose from K right through to year 12. So what sort of things do you think you might do with your students? There are things specifically that are done with code.org. There are things within Scratch. You might make a card or you might make some music. For older students, they might like to learn JavaScript, or they might like to learn some Python. All those options are available. Maybe you'd like to combine it with a learning area and do some artwork. So there are a number of different ways of using coding and art together. You could try some puzzles out. You could try some unplugged activities. The thing I usually hear from teachers the most is, which activity do I choose? So sometimes I suggest a couple and then they try them out and see what works. No one thing is going to work for each school. It's a matter of understanding your context, your students, your accessibility, and which way you'd like to go. While you're doing your tutorial checks, it's always good to troubleshoot in advance. Make sure your technology is going to work for your event. For instance, do you have enough devices if that's what you're using? Will you need to set up different groups or different pairing structures for your students? Make sure you test everything on the devices that the students will be using. It doesn't mean go through every device, but it does mean make sure if you're using iPads, it's going to work on an iPad. If you're using a laptop, it's going to work. What type of browser might you be using? Because Internet Explorer isn't supported for many things anymore. I had the experience the other day of trying one of the tutorials and it required Flash. And I went, oh dear, I can't use that one. And my daughter came up and went, oh no, Mum, you just need to turn it on with this button here. So it is possible, but you just need to make sure you've tested it on those devices. check your bandwidth as well, because if you're doing any video streaming, you want to make sure that the bandwidth isn't being choked at your school at that particular time as well. We mentioned the headphones before, and maybe preview some of the congratulation pages and see what's there as well. There are certificates for printing, so you might want to test those out and have those ready as well for students at the end of your hour of code. And always have a look at the frequently asked questions, just in case there are any things that you come up against that you're unsure of. Then you start the coding. And this picture here shows you many, many options that are available. But try your tutorials out first. You're going to get into the coding and maybe try some with teachers. You could have an afternoon of coding with the teachers and get them to try something different and then share what was working, what's not working. You've got things like Minecraft in there. So if your students are familiar with Minecraft, that might suit them. You have the AI for oceans. So students are learning about artificial intelligence and how that works. There's an arcade game and they're learning about what arcade games used to be like and how you can build your own. There are scratch options, as I mentioned before. So there are lots and lots of different things that are available, and they've been created by different partners for the Hour of Code. And then, as I mentioned before, don't forget the certificate. It's always good to have that certificate and hand it out to the students at the end of their hour. Maybe do a bit of a debrief as well. What did they learn? It wasn't just cool or just awesome, but what did they actually do? Was there some repetition that they used? And there's some stickers. You could also hand out stickers or make badges with the I Did the Hour of Code sheet that's available. So right now we're going to go in and have a look at what some of those 1 hour activities involve. And there are some filters on the system that also assist you. And we'll get into those a little bit later. But if you see across the top here, we've got all grades, or if I'm an early years teacher, I might just want the pre-reader or things that start at the pre-reader level. If I'm a primary school teacher, I might go straight to the grades 2 to 5, which is where these particular tutorials start. Or if I'm looking at older primary or maybe middle school, let's look at the grades 6 to 8 and what's available there. And then for the older students, grades 9 and onwards. It also gives you the option, if you're a beginner or if you're comfortable with coding, which way you'd like to go. So for our early years, I've brought up a few for you to have a look at. I did play with Candy Quest earlier, and it was extremely loud, and it actually took me to exactly where I'd finished off, which I thought was interesting, but we'll see if we can go back and have a look at it. I just wanted to show you, though, this one up here, Computer Science in 60 Seconds. The books about Ruby that are written by Linda, what's her surname, Lucas. Hello, Ruby. Now Linda has made some 60-second videos which go through a lot of the Hello, Ruby activities, and these are unplugged. So if you're looking at something unplugged, if you've got the book, if you've been using it with your students, then these might be just what you're looking for your Hour of Code. You have Scratch Junior. If you have iPads in your school, you can download Scratch Junior onto that. That's a free app. And there are some activities within that. One I've tried earlier is Lightbot. That one is also a very interesting one and easy for students to follow. And then this is a new one from iCompute, and they also have some unplugged activities, and there's some sheets there that you might like to hand out to students, and they can go through some unplugged activities with that one. Celia, I'm going to give Candy Quest a little go and see how this works. So with Candy Quest, when I click on the link, it takes me straight to
Twitter. Use jump to avoid the thimble and reach the mint.
It actually goes through a video and shows you what you need to do.
Each jump block makes your character jump over an obstacle and land on the other side.
I think I'm at the third level. So just go back here to the first level.
So your voice is...
So to begin with, you start by choosing a character. So I might choose this little character down here. And then I have the option, if I like, to change the eyes, to change the hair, to change the feet, the smile, any of those things. And I have, I think it was about 60 seconds or 2 minutes, about 60 seconds to change my character. If I just want to move on, I can just click start. So there is a bit of music with this.
I'm going to teach you how to play Candy Quest. Attach the walk block to the on start block. Drag the walk block. Great job! Attach another walk block.
So what I'm doing is grabbing my mouse.
Drag the walk block.
And dragging the walk block underneath.
Great job!
So these are very self-led tutorials.
A gumdrop. Program your character to walk to the gumdrop.
So down the side I get my program and I have to click anywhere to continue. So I have to count how many steps do I want her to go. 1, 2, 3 and then I think there's a fourth one. So I'm going to grab walk, 1, 2, 3 So that one comes with Tinker, and as I say, it's self-led, very easy for your students. It's got some exciting sounds and music, and it's attractive to that age group. If I move on to your primary school age, grades 2 to 5, there are some old favourites still here. Code.org had these around about 4, 5, maybe even 6 years ago. So make a flappy game. So you go through a process of doing that. Minecraft, of course, is always popular. As I said, they have some unplugged activities. This is an example with graph programming. And this new one, which is Play, Design and Code a Retro Arcade. I've had a bit of a play in there and it's fun. But I'm going to look at this tried and true Star Wars. There's also Frozen in there, but I'm going to try it now. What's really interesting is I can try it with blocks or I can try it in JavaScript. So that gives me now an age range of where I'd like to start. Now, each one of these starts with a video, which is really helpful because they're giving you a bit of a background about who they are and what they've been doing. But you can skip over those and go straight into it. The instructions are up there. And so we need that scrap metal for BB. 8, can you get it? So say OK. So this one, it says add a second move right command to your code. So this is interesting because now I'm using my lefts and my rights and ups and downs rather than forward and backward. So the language has now changed a little bit. So if I move right which is really good for positional language. Maybe if I move right again, I'll be able to collect my piece of scrap. Congratulations. So there we go. So then it'll take me on to level two. And this time I need to change some of my movements. So we need more scrap metal. So I've already tried, I can go across. So there's one, there's the second one. But then I want him to move down. And as he's going to move down two spots and click run. Okay, so these are very introductory, basic ways of starting. And then as you move on, it then builds in complexity. They've noticed the music has also changed, because we've got someone over here out to catch BB-8. So now I have to move him to catch, to grab this scrap metal, but also go up to get some more scrap metal. And then as we build on in complexity, if I go to number 9, stop it at that point and move on to the next one. Now, when we look at our secondary years, our middle years students, it does have years 6 to 8. Some schools do start middle years at year 6. Some start at year 7, some have year 9s in there, but these ones are generally for the year 6 to 8 group. So you can see that there's an unplugged activity using cards. There's the Khan Academy with some JavaScript. We have a Python one here with soccer ball slopes. And this one down here is from Code HS. And they are, this one's an unplugged activity as well. So I won't go into the Code HS one, but that one is around the using of JavaScript. And then we move on to the year 9. So the year 9s are all into Python or Java, but there are some block options and there are some more unplugged options as well. So this coding in art is one that looks around blocks. Now what Code HS have done is with their specific Hour of Code activities, they've done up this really interesting table for you to choose which tutorial might suit that group and their experience. So if you're dealing with students that have got no coding experience at all, and they're in around grades 6 to 8, then they've given you some options here of what you might like to try. Similar again, same options if they're beginners around code. And these build on with complexity into which type of activity you would like to do depending on the age level and depending on the experience level of your students. So choose the right tutorial is what that's all about. Then, as I mentioned before, there are a number of unplugged activities. So this one is with graph paper, and you find a lot of these on the code.org website, where they have their curriculum and they show you a whole list of unplugged activities. And these ones are fun to do, lots of different levels for the students. So you can start with the younger years and they build in complexity for the older students. One of the favourites that I've known is the My Robotic Friends that seems to work across all age levels, where the students are actually hands-on building stacks with the cups, but they're actually using the coding language with arrows of moving forwards or backwards or up or down And then they can actually walk these out themselves as well, so that the students are physically the robot doing the activity. Now, for the Hour of Code activities, code.org will be running some code bites, so some very short 20-minute interactive computer science lessons during Computer Science Education Week. So if you go to code.org/codebytes, you'll find out more about those. Now, they are run on American time, but I'm sure that they will be recorded. And if you register, then you should be able to get the recordings. Code.org also have all their activities from grades K to 5, 6 to 12, and then what do you want to do beyond your Hour of Code in the whole K to 12 space? So it's time for you to choose your activities. So as I mentioned before, there are a whole lot of filters, and you can start by your year levels going across the top, whether or not they're beginners or if they're comfortable. Then you might like to look at who they're created by. There's a long, long list of things. And before I mentioned CodeHS, so if you wanted to look at just their activities, you would click on the button, choose CodeHS. If you want just code.org activities, then select that one. You've got Tinker options, Scratch options, Codable options. There's a whole host. And if you want to narrow down into a particular group, you can use that option there. Have a think about the technology that you're using. So if you're only using iPads, then it's best to tick that particular box, and the tutorials that you will come up will be specific to iPads. If you're looking for unplugged ones, then go to no computers or devices. If you're thinking about doing some activities that are integrated with learning areas, then I suggest choose one of the topics of science, maths, social studies, language arts, etc. If you just want computer science ones, tick that box. If you're looking for tutorials that are self-led, like I showed you with Candy Quest just before, then click on that one. But if you're thinking you want to try some things on your own, then click on the lesson plans and you'll find all the things that have lesson plans with them. If you're looking at just 1 hour, then click the 1 hour option in the filter. But if you want the 1 hour and then some follow-on activities, and choose that one. I'm just looking at the time. We have about 12 minutes left. So, Celia, I'm just going to stop at that point. Are there any questions in the chat?
No, there's no questions at the moment, but Tony has mentioned that My Robotic Friend was one of her favourite, and Leanne likes Lightbot, but mentions that it uses Flash. Did you say there was a solution to that?
Yes. Shall I attempt to find that solution?
Give it a go.
So we're going to just spend maybe 5 minutes. I'd like people, if you could, Celia, could you put hourofcode.com.au/learn into the chat? Mm-hmm. So when people click on it, they should be able to open up the Hour of Code activities.
Yep, Leanne's asking whether that solution for the Flash activity works for Apple products.
I don't know. I don't have an Apple one, so possibly not.
That might be an issue still.
Right. So here's Lightbot. I'm going to click on that one. When you click on your activity, it gives you a little bit of information what it's about. When I click on start, it will then open it up. And then here we go. So it says, are you using it online? Well, you'll need Flash in your browser. Are you using it on an iPad or an iPhone? Then make click this option. If you're using a tablet, which is an Android, choose this option. So there's an answer in terms of this one gives you the options. What I did was clicked on the Flash in browser, and it told me that that's not available. And then my very clever daughter said, that's okay, Mum, because if you look up in the top corner, you can enable it. Only she's not here to look over my shoulder to show me. So I cannot enable it. Maybe we were doing it in Internet Explorer. But what I do like is the fact that they have given you the option, if you're using an iPad or an iPhone, you can click on that one and it will take you there. There you go. And so you're able to download it from the App Store.
Okay, so I guess that means in schools it needs to be pre-prepared.
If schools have managed devices, this is all part of our testing. I guess that's why in that planning and preparing phase, and I'm talking about people, making sure that you test it on the devices prior to your event. Because, yeah, this is one that needs to be downloaded first.
So Tony's looking at the light bot. You have to download it first. So in a school, you'd obviously, as you just said, have done that as part of your due diligence in your preparation, didn't you?
Yeah. Yeah, and I'm just trying to work out why I could do this with my daughter the other day and now I can't do it at all. Because we got this little message that came up. Oh, here we go. So can you see that on my screen? That hasn't come across? Okay, so I went into Internet Explorer and it's working perfectly there. So again, it's really important to test your browser and make sure that, just turn it off, we've got music. Make sure that things are going to work as well.
Okay, we've only got a couple more minutes.
Sure. All right, so moving on. As I mentioned, there are some resources. There are some how-to guides at thehourofcode.com/au. And I emphasize the AU, so you go to the Australian option rather than the global option. And you will see things there for educators, if you're going to have a school assembly, if there are things for parents, if you want to have some volunteers, what they can do, and if you decide to run a virtual event, how that would work as well. And as I mentioned earlier, there are all those promotional materials. And over at code.org, they have mini lessons, then those are those code bites. The Code HS, they have the hour-long tutorials, and this website, SMORE, that I found today, they're running Code Bites interactive short lessons as well. So both this site and code.org will be running Code Bites during that particular week. So just a reminder that after the Hour of Code, you might like to consider taking teachers through the our massive open online courses. If they're primary aged, they might like to, sorry, if they're primary teachers, they might like to look at our foundations and our extended courses. For secondary teachers, look at our next steps and explore courses. If you're looking at more about artificial intelligence and augmented reality and virtual reality in the classroom, then take a look at our Teaching AI in the Classroom course. And of course, we've got cybersecurity and awareness for both primary teachers and secondary. There's two there. We'd like to have some feedback. So if you can go to bit.ly, our CSER webinar feedback link. Celia, if you can pop that in the chat, that would be really great to have some feedback on today's session. And next Thursday on December the 3rd, my colleague Peter Lalong from Tasmania, he's going to be taking people through the Google Tour Creator and how to build a virtual tour. So on that note, I'll say thank you, everyone. And if there's no further questions, just make sure you keep in touch. Facebook, Twitter, and our CSER YouTube channel.